I want to say two things before I get started on my talk. One is that I am in a center with 8 other faculty members, and I'm aware of the resources I have. I realize that we are resource rich in terms of financial resources and human resources. So there's 8 of us that are trained in psychometrics, data management, statistics, and research design. In addition, we teach an assessment and measurement PhD program and a quantitative methods master's program. So we have a lot of manpower in the form of our students. And I want to say all that because when I talk about everything we're doing, you might be like, how is she getting all of that done? And it's not just me. It's me and my colleagues and a boatload of students that we train. All right. The second thing is, you're going to hate the size of my font. All right. But I'm okay with that.
Well, we have to have something.
That's right. Yeah, directed towards that. I built this slide deck so that after, when the decks are disseminated, which they will be, you guys will have enough detail that if you want to implement some of the things we're implementing, you can do that. Or if you want to reach out to me or Keston, there's enough information there that you can be specific about what it is you want to work on. I'm only going to talk about one thing today, and that's specifically the student perspective in evaluating program effectiveness, and in particular, test-taking motivation. But you're going to hear me talk about a lot of other things, like our designs, our implementation fidelity, our mandatory testing, things like that. And if you want to talk to me about that, or Keston, please feel free to do that. Okay. So basically at JMU, we want to assess the educational effectiveness of about 120 degree programs, 5 general education areas, and dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of student affairs programs, because we service the whole university. So what we tend to do is assess student learning outcomes before and after some intervention, innovation, curriculum, pedagogy. We tend to have comparison groups. We don't do randomized control trials, but we tend to have comparison groups. So what we often see is sometimes the gain is minor. All right, there's not as much gain in critical thinking, ethical reasoning, quantitative ability, sense of belonging, civic engagement, yada, yada. And there's a series of hypotheses that the faculty will put forth, and we work through. All right, so the program works, Sara. We know it works. The outcome measures suck. They don't have good psychometric quality. There's not enough reliability and validity associated with it, but the program works. The program works. It wasn't implemented well. The faculty didn't do what they said they were going to do. The implementers didn't engage in the program on paper. Students never received the program. The program works. The students didn't try on the outcome measures because there's no consequences personally for them trying. And then you have a lone voice. Maybe the program doesn't work. Okay? So what we do is our team and students engage in ruling these hypotheses out. We're psychometricians. We don't allow them to make program inferences unless the measures are okay. All right? So we help create instrumentation and evaluate instrumentation so we can rule that out. We engage in implementation fidelity assessment, which I'm willing to talk to you all about, but we actually go in and audit courses to see if things are happening as planned. And we merge that data with the outcomes data. So then that leaves 3 and 4. And what I want to talk about is 3, the student experience and all of this efficacy, effectiveness study stuff we're talking about. And I want to talk about how low effort can really have an impact on the inferences you can make about the effectiveness of your programs. All right. So what is test-taking effort? Well, there's a lot of us in the US and then also, gosh, in Germany and Sweden and New Zealand, all our friends all over, that basically say it's the extent to which students give their best effort to the test, with the goal being to accurately represent what one knows and can do in the content area covered by the test. Then that immediately leads to, what kind of test are you talking about? Is it high stakes or is it low stakes? And in high stakes tests, effort tends to be high and there's not a lot of variability in effort. In low stakes tests, effort can be low and there's a lot more variability in effort. All right, so we've got students not giving effortful responses. They're giving minimal effort. That leads directly to a validity issue. And we all fall under the standards for psychological and educational testing. And those standards say when you're going to gather scores in non-consequential contexts, you have to gather motivation data. You're going to interpret those scores and make some kind of decision about program effectiveness. All right, and so that's where we're coming from, is like we have an ethical obligation to assess these variables that may be impacting the validity of the scores. How we do that at JMU is two ways. We have a self-report measure. It's short. It's at the end of the slide deck. It's about 10 items. It's used in several countries, several organizations, really easy to give. We also do it undercover. When students are on the computer, we use something called response time effort. Both tend to flag non-effortful responders well, and there's a series of papers at the end that where we show that essentially you could use either or if you want. All right, so we know we can measure test-taking motivation, and we have. So what if we found over and over and over, and what have our friends found? Well, unfortunately, the empirical studies show there's a pretty strong relationship between test-taking effort and performance on the test. All right, so that means you just construct a relevant variance in those test scores. All right, the thing that's the most disturbing, at least to me, because we do pre-post test designs, is there's differential effort. So when we assess the kids at pre-test, they tend to give a lot of effort towards those tests. When we assess them at post-test, they're like, peace out, I'm not giving effort. What does that do to your effect? It attenuates your effect. And then you make inferences that your program isn't effective, not because it's not effective, it's because the students aren't engaging in the test. So what do? One thing you can do is something called motivation filtering. And that is literally going in with whatever measure you engaged in terms of test-taking motivation and removing students that are giving invalid responses. C, 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 you know, B, 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 B on these computer-based tests, remove them, okay? And it's been shown over and over and over and over in studies that you're actually going to get more valid representation of ability if you do that. Reliability of your test goes up as well. But there's a lot of people that are like, I don't want to remove people post hoc. That seems weird, pulling students out of our data set. I don't like that. Even if you're telling me their data's wonky, I don't want to do it. Well, then it's our responsibility to motivate those students in those low-stakes testing contexts. So if you want to get on the front end of it, you've got to do something about it. So my last slide is about that. This is work that we're doing, and please, if you want to engage in it, let me know, to increase effort on the front end. And one is, and this is all expectancy value theory, if you increase the perceived importance of the test, it's going to lead to greater effort, which will lead to greater performance. We don't do this at JMU, but some of our friends do pay for performance. So your students get paid, okay, in terms of if they do well. We don't do that. There's issues with, having money and also IRB issues. Also, the results are mixed. If you pay guys, they tend to perform better. If you pay girls, they don't. Test instructions, this is what we do. We go in and manipulate the test instructions. We still keep the test low stakes, but we change the test instructions to see if we can increase the personal relevance. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. It's really mixed, but it's low cost, easy for us to do. This is what I'm doing right now. I'm presenting on next month. What we're finding is the students come in, as you would expect, with emotions about the test. Those emotions change during the test. So we use these pretty cool longitudinal designs where we measure things like boredom, pride, enjoyment, and anger. Students get more pissed off as the test goes on, and effort goes down. So if anger is if change in anger is correlated with change in effort, we're going to have less valid scores towards the end of the test. So now what we're thinking about is can we go in and change that state emotion, kind of the psychology of the examinee, so that they're not as angry and it might be a more enjoyable experience and thus they'll give forth more effort. I'll stop there.
Thank you very much.